He's an NBA writer, Mark Medina. We've had him on multiple times on this show. Former Laker beat writer, Warriors beat writer, covering the NBA for years. The NBA draft, we were just going over the last 10 number one picks. There's three busts. There's Zion, whatever that's becoming. It's hard because they're young. It's a global sport. There's a big map to cover. You talked to an executive about Victor Wembanyama, tomorrow's number one pick. What's the feeling on him? How good would he make the Spurs?
Well, Colin, it's an interesting question on Victor Wembanyama because it's a consensus answer that he's going to be a generational talent. He's going to have a Hall of Fame resume because he has point guard skills and a big man's body, and he's all about the work, and he's in love with the game, and he's coachable. But when it comes to the short term, I asked one executive from another team that's not in the lottery, as well as another head coach, the question, can the Spurs make the playoffs next season? They said no. The reality is, the Spurs have a very young roster, and while Victor Wembanyama can have an instant impact with his game, I think that's just a lot to ask for a player even of his caliber. And I think it also illustrates a key difference that San Antonio had when they drafted Tim Duncan. Keep in mind that they had the position to get that number one pick because David Robinson and, to a lesser extent, Chuck Person had some notable injuries that season. But once Tim Duncan was back, they had a veteran-laden roster team around him, so they were able to make the playoffs, get to the second round his rookie season, his second season, win that championship in that lockout-shortened season. So while there will be short-term differences, I think the long-term trajectory is still pretty high, that he is the real deal and the hype is warranted.
Scoot Henderson, what are the execs saying about him? He's got a Derrick Rose quality. What's the sense on what kind of player he'll be and how quickly?
Yeah, Colin, it's interesting you mentioned Derrick Rose. I asked G League Ignite coach Jason Hart about player comps, and he brought up Derrick Rose because of his explosiveness. But he also added Jason Kidd because of how well he manages the game. And so I think that there's mixed feelings. Will Scoot Henderson or Brandon Miller go two or three? There is a feeling that Scoot Henderson is the best guard in the draft and that he will make an instant impact. Now, there are obviously some notable discussions about his weaknesses with his shooting, and that's very real. But when you talk to people with the G League Ignite, as well as people outside of that organization, they feel that, one, his shooting numbers will get substantially better because he puts in the work. He's considered a gym rat.
Yeah.
But number two, he's not going to become a Steph Curry, even if he's working out with him. But his calling card is going to be about getting to the basket, exploding with athleticism, making the right play, elevating his teammates. But I think through time, his three-point shooting will be respectable enough that's not considered a liability.
Saw a rumor on Paul George with the Blazers, Bam at a Bayou, Portland. Dame says, I want to stay. They've got the number three pick. Do you buy the rumors? Is there a chance Portland trades out of three? They get a veteran player. What do you make of those rumors?
Well, Colin, in today's NBA, you always have to consider that anything is possible, right? But if I had to guess, I think if Portland does make a move before the draft, it involves the number three pick in hopes to get a veteran player to play with Damian Lillard as opposed to trading him. And as far as, you know, Paul George with the Clippers, look, I've been told even since the beginning of their early playoff exit that they are committed to Paul George and Kawhi Leonard, at least through the end of their contracts, which expire in 2 years, because there's optimism. They can get healthy, even if they haven't shown otherwise, because they're still in their prime. But, you know, look, anything goes in today's NBA. And when you look at Miami, I think it is very telling what Pat Riley was talking about with not wanting to blow up everything, but also knowing Pat Riley is an aggressive executive. So he's certainly going to do his due diligence to see if he can get someone like Damian Lillard. But I think everything is on the table, and it's going to be interesting to see how those dominoes sort itself out.
All right, Draymond Green spotted with LeBron in Paris. There's a story today by Bill Ryder, a guy at CBS I know, that LeBron at times frustrated with AD. I think we all saw AD get worked by Jokic, was good offensively in every other game. And I do think LeBron kind of looks around the league and thinks, I'm getting old, I need guys that are available. Draymond Green, I would guess, would re-sign if the number's right with the Warriors. Is there any chance he would be a Laker or leave the Warriors?
I would doubt that he would be with the Lakers just because of fit, even though Draymond Green's obviously a substantial talent and can dramatically change any team. I would be skeptical that happens. Now, if he leaves the Warriors, I think that's very much in play, just with the idea that he opted out of his contract. Maybe if he gets some good offers elsewhere, the Warriors wind up doing a sign-and-trade. But I think at the end of the day, if I had to make a guess, the Warriors and Draymond Green reunite. They know that they're better off with each other. But I think in Draymond's case, he wants to see what his value is out in the open market. He also doesn't take lightly the value in having some sort of security. But I think that even if they have to sort out the numbers from the Warriors end, and there are luxury tax concerns, they have shown over the years that they're willing to do what it takes to retain Draymond Green. But, you know, they're going to have to show it.
You know, it's you kind of look at the Phoenix Suns. They kind of stole Bradley Beal. And now they've got Booker, Beal, and Durant. Those are great perimeter players. Deandre Ayton does have a market. He's going to give you 18 and 10. But it looks like now, Mark, he's not going to get any looks for Phoenix. And we've seen him before. When he doesn't touch the ball offensively, he can pout and be disengaged. Well, he's not going to get any looks on this offense. So it feels like, realistically, you could move him. They also need bodies to fill out that bench in rotation. Is there a place for Deandre Ayton that you look at? I think the Knicks is interesting. If you could get a Josh Hart and a Mitchell Robinson and a pick over to Phoenix, that makes some sense. Is there a place Deandre Ayton fits, in your opinion? Because I just don't think that's going to work with him getting virtually no offensive attention. He was upset when Booker and Kevin Durant ignored him. Now you got Beal taking shots. What do you make of Ayton's situation?
Yeah, I'm with you 100%. I think New York would be a great fit, both for what New York needs and what the Suns need. And look, let's just split the difference. I know Rick Bucher had some, you know, really strong analysis about the Suns trade, and he disagreed. I view it in this way. I think that the chemistry with Bradley Beal and Devin Booker, Kevin Durant, are going to be fine. I mean, they're great talents. I think all players involved have shown that they know how to coexist with other good players. But I did scratch my head a little bit at the trade, just knowing that last season's playoff shortcomings partly had to do with health, and none of those three players have had those kind of track records with being able to stay healthy on a consistent basis. And then the lack of depth. And so I think that when you view this move, it's good that they got Bradley Beal, especially for what they gave up. But I think that there needs to be another move in play, whether it involves Deandre Ayton to fill out the rest of the roster to address some of those positional needs, or see if they can convince some really good rotation players to take veteran minimum deals because they have a championship caliber roster. But I think that because that there's always an unknown of the latter, their best play is to see what the market is for Deandre Ayton to fill out all those depth concerns that Rick and I have.
All right. Your guess today, number three pick, Portland, number three pick, your guess today, they're going to keep it or move it?
Wow. I think they're going to keep it. I think that they're certainly going to entertain the trade offers, but I think at the end of the day, they wind up keeping it. They draft Scoot Henderson. Brandon Miller goes to Charlotte at number two. And as far as Scoot, look, he's played on and off the ball. And while his main strength is being a playmaker with the ball, he'll have to adjust to that, obviously, with Damian Lillard. They can deal with, you know, that concern later. They have an asset moving forward. And yeah, so I think that's ultimately what's going to happen.
Mark, great seeing you as always. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.